Having CO2 on the car, someone forgetting to do something, has lost countless races. It doesn't matter what you do, it could be CO2 on the top, whatever pressure you like, that valve is moving around. If you can eliminate one more variable, you can't get the CO2 wrong if you don't have it.
Boost control is one of the most critical elements with any turbocharged vehicle. We're here with Matt from Turbosmart to talk about their electronic wastegates. Where do the advantages lie? In other words, why did OEs move from pneumatic to electronic wastegates?
So from an OE perspective, I mean, you've got a lot more control over exhaust back pressure. You can do some EGR, you can do some relatively complex engine control when you've got more control of the position of the wastegate and therefore exhaust back pressure than just what you can do pneumatically, especially when you couple that with direct injection. So those two things in particular are really tight control of the engine emissions and what you can do with emissions. By the time you've got EGR, which is all electronic, you've got a wastegate that's now electronic, and you've got direct injection, so you're putting fuel directly into the combustion chamber. From an OEM perspective, there is a lot of advantage in having full control of everything on the intake side, exhaust side, also the recirc between the two. That's OEM. I think from a Turbosmart perspective in the aftermarket, especially with these big electronic wastegates that we're doing, it's less about emissions and it's a lot more about reliability and repeatability in specific racing applications.
Now, I'm glad that you mentioned specific racing applications, because what I'm interested in finding out is, if I'm an enthusiast and I don't have a wastegate at this stage, when should I be looking at an electronic wastegate in comparison to a pneumatic wastegate?
For starters, I'd say that an electronic wastegate really finds its home specifically in drag racing. And there's a few specific reasons for that. With drag racing, obviously starting from a start, but you've got a fixed amount of time between you pull into the staging, then you can come up on boost, and then the short track itself, I mean, that's where all the magic happens. You know, you've got a really tight control of power delivery over the short tracks. I mean, if you were to look at the acceleration of a vehicle on a drag strip, that first 60 feet, maybe 110 feet, is where the most of the acceleration happens.
Getting consistent launches is so critical, but with a turbocharged engine, a lot of this really comes down to having exactly the same boost pressure when you release the clutch every time, or get off the trans brake for that matter. Is there an advantage there with an electronic wastegate?
Yeah, that's exactly where the advantage lies. So drag racing setup where you're at the start line, your foot's on the throttle, you're either sitting on the trans brake or two-step, you're going to set the whole vehicle up around how much power you can drive down to the tire through the suspension when you release the trans brake or you release the clutch. That's drag racing. It's that first 60 feet. Having a wastegate that you can say, okay, I want to, every single time I'm on the start line, I want to be at this position, regardless of where the engine's banging and popping on the two-step. If you look at a pneumatic gate, is a really good example. If you actually look at the valve position on a pneumatic gate when you're on the two-step, it doesn't matter what you do, it could be CO2 on the top, whatever pressure you like, that valve is moving around.
That's as a result of the exhaust manifold back pressure is fluctuating. So even if you're using CO2 control and you've got stable pressure on the top of the diaphragm, it's what's happening to the pressure on the underside of the valve that's making it move up and down.
That's exactly right. Depending on whether you, when you release the clutch, the valve could be high, could be low, could be somewhere in between, could be moving up, could be moving down. That is going to affect your short track time. That lack of repeatability is where one pass, you know, the thing just stood up on the tire and went, and the next pass, it shook the tire, or any number of things that happened in the first 60 feet of drag racing.
Now, we just sort of brought in CO2 boost control, which is something that's kind of almost specific to drag racing. One of the problems with a pneumatic wastegate is we have a limited range of control. So, you know, let's say we've got a 10 psi spring in the wastegate, which should give us there or thereabouts maybe 10 psi without any electronic intervention, but you're not going to get from 10 psi up to 80. So there's only a limited range. Obviously, we get around this with CO2 control. However, the electronic gate also gets around this, correct?
Yeah, that's exactly right. In fact, many years ago, for the electronic gate, was exactly that. Customers coming to us who have our CO2 gates and say, oh, we lost the race because we didn't turn the CO2 bottle on, or we ran out of CO2, or the regulator shoots up, or a line came off, whatever it may be. Having CO2 on the car, someone forgetting to do something, has lost countless races. If you can eliminate one more variable, where it's just, I mean, you can't get the CO2 wrong if you don't have it. And that's actually was the impetus for the electronic gate to start with. Then you start looking at it more and more, you're like, oh, there's actually quite a few additional advantages, more than just I forgot to turn the bottle on. That can be solved with, is the bottle on, is the nitrous on? You know, again, everyone's got a checklist, but it still happens. It's not like the electronic wastegate replaces the pneumatic wastegate in all applications. In fact, I'd argue that 90% of applications, the pneumatic is still king.
So it's horses for courses, essentially.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, if you've got a street car, you've got a circuit car, 99 times out of 100, I'm saying pneumatic gates do everything you need to do, unless you specifically have a problem that the pneumatic gate cannot address and an electronic gate will address. I can't think of anything that's on my head on a street car or a circuit car, but if you did have that, then you might step up.
Now, another aspect with drag racing specifically is that more often than not with serious drag cars making a lot of power, we'll also incorporate a cold side wastegate to help stabilize that boost control into the intake manifold, or boost level, I should say, into the intake manifold. Is that still going to be a requirement with the electronic gate?
There's two reasons you might want to actually bleed air off the cold side. So if you're bleeding air only off the hot side of the wastegate, then the turbocharger is spinning at the speed that you need to make the boost you're currently making. If you bleed off the cold side, then actually the turbocharger is spinning at a speed greater than the boost that you currently require. So when you let the clutch go and you want to bring the boost in over the first 60 feet, the turbo is already spinning at a greater rate. So you don't need to accelerate the turbo up. It's already spinning higher. So
you've got more energy being provided to the turbocharger than it essentially needs.
It's already providing the energy. It's just that you're bleeding it off the cold side. And in a lot of the pro drag racing and pro mod style drag racing, these guys are moving away from hot side wastegate control completely and only using the electronic wastegate on the intake. And again, horses for courses. I'm not suggesting if you've got a street car, you go ahead and put an intake bleed on that or your boost control, because you're going to get so much exhaust back pressure at high RPM, you're going to lose power. That's the reality.
The next part of this complexity, though, of course, is controlling it. At the time, you kind of created a product that none of the ECU manufacturers could directly control, which created a few headaches, I imagine. So can you talk us through why that was the case, what the complexities are with controlling an electronic wastegate?
So the complexity is obviously it's meta current draw. So you've got a motor in there, you want to move something quickly, so you've got to apply a lot of current to the motor to get the valve to move quickly. I mean, it just comes down to that. Unfortunately, from the ECU perspective, which I do have a bit of experience there, there's a limited amount of current that you can supply over a short period of time. You can supply more, but you need bigger drivers, more current, more heat. The electronic wastegate, it can draw up to 20, 25 amps if you try and drive it quick enough. And so it was an issue. In some circles, it still is an issue. And so that required an external H-bridge driver that could handle higher current. Companies like FuelTech and Haltech, they have those things already. Now Haltech's now got 25 amp drivers built into the ECU, so you can drive them directly from, you know, the R5, R3, those sorts of ECUs. Personally, I still suggest to people, use the external driver. Recognize what you're trying to do by moving that motor very, very quickly is you're going to draw a lot of current. Me personally, I want to try and keep all of that heat away from my multi-$1,000 ECU. So even if the ECU can do it, I still suggest to people, you know what, for the $200 or whatever it is for an external driver, if anything does go wrong, because ultimately when you're putting a wastegate into an engine bay, it's going by the hot things, you know, the turbo and the exhaust manifold, and you might have all your wiring harness clipped back, but one zip tie later, that harness ends up on the manifold, and wire harnesses, they typically don't like exhaust manifold heat. And so it's not uncommon to see wiring around the exhaust end up getting melted. Now, if that happens, and no, it shouldn't, but if it does, I don't want to also take out my $5,000 ECU.
Cheaper to potentially damage a $200 external driver than your entire ECU.
That's exactly right. Even though the ECU can do it, I still suggest to people, you know what, peace of mind, I prefer to drive it externally.
And safe to assume here that this is now a product that Turbosmart have created as a driver for the electronic wastegate range.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So we've got our own black box, which we've had for a couple of years now, and we're working on a few more products to be able to control electronic wastegates in particular. So that's a bit of an Easter egg there. There'll be some new products in our range for that. We've got our own box. The ECU manufacturers have their own box. It's a great product in specific applications, and the ECU manufacturers that are big in those applications have recognized that. And yeah, I mean, they're electronic experts too. And so they've come to the party and said, oh yeah, we know electronics, we can handle that. And even speak to those guys, most of those manufacturers will say the same thing. Yeah, we can run it through one of the drivers on the ECU, but we still recommend driving it externally.
Well, look, I think at this stage, we've got a better understanding of what the electronic wastegate is, and now a better understanding of where it's probably best suited. Obviously, if people want to find out more about the product or purchase, how they're best to do so.
Of course, website, turbosmart.com. You can follow us on Facebook, Instagram.
YouTube.
Yeah, we're all those places.
All of the socials.
All the socials, that's right.
Perfect. Thanks for the insight into the product, Matt.
Thanks for having me.